Metal Injection Livecast is about to give you a look beyond the band.
Our special guest this week is renowned A&R rep Monte Connor. Monte, are you
hey,
there?
Hey, Rob, how you doing?
Oh, thank you.
I am here.
Awesome, awesome. Monte, thank you so much for taking some time to hang out with us here on the live cast. I'm not the only one on the air. I'm here with Noah.
Hi, Monte.
Darren.
Hey, Noah, how are you?
Hi, Monte, what's up?
And Sid.
Hello.
Hey, Darren.
We're all fellow Brooklyn, New York Jews. And
wait, although did you say New York Jews?
Yeah, everyone in this room is Jewish.
Yeah. Although it's
did you know I'm Jewish as well?
Of course.
Yes. I mean, but we just want to make sure that you know it's not a requirement to be a part of this podcast.
No, no, no. It's
even
coincidence.
Even though we're in the top 30 of podcasts that discuss Judaism and Hasidic Jews around Brooklyn.
Well, most people don't realize I'm Jewish because Connor is a very Irish name, but when you spell it with an E-R like me, it means you're a member of the tribe.
Oh, now I know.
And Monte, you've been doing this now for over 30 years. I don't want to make you seem older than you are, but quite a while, a few decades.
Let's put it this way. Yes. I've been doing this so long that when I started doing it and I would have bands come to my office to meet with me, they were my age. Now when I have bands come to my office to meet with them, I can't help but thinking, God, these look like little kids. I mean, that's how long I've been doing it. So.
Right, right. Now,
yeah.
So
that's how I feel when I go to concerts these days. I'm like, wow, everyone around me is just a kid. I've been in this so long.
Yeah, you know, I turned 50 this past year. In fact, I'm just a few months from 51, and it's a pretty sobering experience when you go to a show and you're like side by side with, you know, 16-year-old kids. You start thinking like, God, how long can I be doing this? Do I want to be here when I'm 60 years old? Who the hell knows? But, you know, like musicians, you know, once you're in this business, you kind of become spoiled. Like, are you ever going to retire? And of course, musicians don't want to retire. That's why you see a guy like Lemmy who's going to, you know, literally be doing it until he dies on stage. And you see guys like the Rolling Stones who are still doing it in their 70s. And, you know, nobody's going to give up. Basically, everybody's going to go until they die. That's just the way it is.
Yeah, it's a sweet gig. Why give it up?
And you're also like a part of the, you know, you're a fabric in the quilt. Like you know, just the fact that you go to shows now and there are people who are teenagers who are there is just kind of like a testament to how long metal has been preserved and how, you know, this is definitely an industry that is thriving.
Well, I mean, it's really true. You're seeing right now what, I mean, metal is like a relatively modern invention. When did it start? You know, like in the 60s with Zeppelin and Sabbath and Deep Purple, or, you know, even if it started with Priest in the you know, mid 70s, you're still looking at uncharted territories as far as like metal bands reaching their 50s and 60s for the first time ever. And you're basically seeing, you know, who can keep going and who can, you know, I mean, how long is the, when you're thinking about singers specifically, like how a metal singer go on? Obviously you have someone like Mick Jagger doing it well into his 70s and he looks amazing and he sounds great, but look at it from a metal point of view, like look how much harder it is to sing metal. Yeah. You know, are you going to see Rob Halford doing this in his 70s or Bruce Dickinson? You know, so it's really, truly uncharted territories as we see what happens with these metal musicians as they start hitting their 60s and 70s, you know, because it's a much more demanding type of music than what the Rolling Stones are doing, for example.
Sure.
Yeah. And but let's shift the focus a little to your job. You have basically the sweetest gig in the music industry outside of perhaps being, you know, in
also, I feel like there aren't really that many A&R guys.
Yeah. Well, what I wanted to start off with is I'm curious, like, when you started, the music industry was a completely different beast than it is now. You know, now you could listen to a band's demo online. How did you get involved in the, like, how did you get Roadrunner to trust you to sign bands? Like how did you get started with A&R?
If I can start at the beginning, you know, I didn't grow up and, you know, I didn't go to college. I never had aspirations. I did go to college, but what I was saying is when I was in college, you know, I never had aspirations to do A&R. I never wanted to work in the music business. It kind of just happened by accident. I went to school right here in the city at Baruch College on 23rd Street, which is a business school. Mm-hmm. And I really didn't know what I wanted to do when I went to school. So I started majoring in math just because math was an easy A for me. I was always good with numbers. And basically, while I was at the school, I joined the college radio station. The call letters were WBMB. And, it was this little tiny radio station, literally just like went around campus. You couldn't hear it more than a few blocks away. And I had a metal show when I was there called The Witching Hour, which was on 1 hour every week. And I did it for all 4 years of college. And when I was at this station, I was playing all the underground stuff of the day, Slayer, Anthrax, Megadeth, Metallica, Sepultura, Annihilator, all the cool stuff, you know, years in some cases before these bands were signed. And through the radio show, I made connections to various record labels. So, I would get records sent to me by Metal Blade, Combat, Megaforce, all the cool labels of the day. And I established a few relationships and basically got out of college and begged everyone for a job. And one guy hired me, this guy David Carpin, that worked at a tiny, tiny independent label called Shatter Records. You know, the only thing of note on Shatter was, have you heard of Paul Di'Anno's Battle Zone?
I've heard of Paul Di'Anno, but never.
No, Battle Zone.
Yeah. Paul, Battle Zone was the band that Paul Di'Anno formed after he left Iron Maiden.
Okay.
And that was like the only thing we had of note on the label. But anyway, as I said, I worked at the station for 4 years. I made as many contacts as I could. And, you know, the station was pretty much the training ground for me as far as having skills to do A&R. Because, as I said, while I was at this station, I was featuring basically all the bands that were emerging from the speed, thrash, death, black metal scenes, although it wasn't called black metal at the time. And I kind of became an expert in that type of music. I lived it. I was 18 years old. It's what I did. It wasn't a job. It's kind of what I listened to, what I did on weekends. I read fanzines. I went to places like L'Amour. And, I kind of became an expert in that type of music. And as I said, when I got out of college, I just begged everyone I could for a job. I worked at the Shatter label for about 9 months before doing radio promotion, by the way, so I wasn't even doing A&R. And then I moved over to Roadrunner in the same position in December 87 as radio promotion.
So what kind of job...
Sorry, what was that?
What kind of job was radio promotions? Like, what were you doing for that?
Radio promotion was and still is, actually, the easiest entry-level job as far as the music business goes. So when I was at Shatter and then at Roadrunner, mm-hmm. when I said radio promotion, really what I meant was college radio promotion. So I would get on the phone all day long for 8 hours a day and call up college radio stations. You know, we're talking stations like WSOU and, you know, which is one of the biggest, as well as all the smaller stations, you know, including stations like WBMB, where I used to work, like really tiny stations. And you'd get on the phone for 8 hours a day and talk to people your own age about metal and try and get them to play your records and put them on a playlist. So you don't have to have any skills whatsoever to do college radio promotion. All you have to do is love metal and be able to talk.
That's
what I started out as. And literally about 7 days after starting there, we were a staff of four or five people at the time. About 7 days after starting, the woman who was doing A&R wound up quitting to go form the label Mechanic Records with Steve Sinclair. So there were four of us left in the office, and the owner of Roadrunner, his name was Case Wessels, he looked around the office, and he's like, okay, well, who can do A&R? And out of the four people there, I was the only young kid that was into it. Everybody else at the label, it was kind of just a job for them, but I was the only person that was into it. So I kind of became A&R by default because there was no one else to do it. That said, Case did realize that I had aspirations to do that because while I was working at the radio station, and I told you I made connections with the various labels, mm-hmm. I would start sending demos around. So if I discovered a cool band like Sepultura or Annihilator, I would send their demos to my friends at Combat and Metal Blade, at Roadrunner, and to try and get these bands signed. So, you know, Case knew I had an ear for it and wanted to do A&R, and basically about 7 days after starting at Roadrunner, I fell into that job by default, and the second band I ever signed was Sepultura, and also in that first year, I signed Obituary and Annihilator, and of course, once these records came out and started to sell, then Case realized that I knew what I was doing, and it became even easier after that for him to trust me and just let me keep going.
That was what I was going to ask. With your first signings, did you kind of have to convince him to that, like, no, this will do? You know, Sepultura is an important band, for example. Or did he kind of trust you from the get-go?
Well, I like to tell everybody that Sepultura is my first signing because that's more of a romantic story, but it was really my second signing.
Okay.
The first signing was a progressive speed metal band out of Milwaukee called Realm, R-E-A-L-M. And they had this amazing speed metal version of Eleanor Rigby by the Beatles, which you can go hear on YouTube. It was great. And that was the first signing. You know, Roadrunner was this tiny little label back then, so we were signing bands for, you know, $10,000, even $15,000 was a lot back then. So it wasn't like it was some big crazy risk to trust me to sign a few bands. There wasn't a whole lot of money involved. But Cates had a really good feeling about me, and he knew I was into it and knew I had connections and that I had, you know, kind of aspired to do that. And he took a chance. And it really wasn't much of a chance because he let me sign four or five bands, and they were all bands that went on to do well. Maybe not home, but Sepultura, Annihilator, Obituary, bands like that did well right out of the gate. And I just kind of kept going and never looked back.
That's great. One of the bands, specifically one of the people that we always talk about here on the live cast, is Peter Steele of Type O Negative.
Yeah, and you mentioned that you used to go to L'Amour and stuff.
And so obviously, yeah, like you saw them there. Were you the one who signed Type O to Roadrunner?
Well, yeah, I was aware of Peter Steele because Carnivore were one of the bands I played on my radio show. And, you know, of course, I'd see them at L'Amour. Mm-hmm. I've seen them probably five or six times in the old days at L'Amour before they were signed. So the story with Type O Negative is that, you know, Peter had done two Carnivore records and then broke the band up.
Right.
And decided to form Type O Negative. Carnivore and Roadrunner didn't exactly have a great relationship. You know, we were, you know, I know now everybody thinks, wow, what an amazing thing it is to be signed to Roadrunner, but back then, we were just like any other label, like just struggling. We barely had a staff. We weren't selling a ton of records. We were kind of on equal footing. Actually, not even on equal footing, because labels like Combat and Megaforce and Metal Blade were way bigger than us in America. So we were this small little label. You know, the first two Carnivore records didn't really sell that well, and Peter wasn't happy, wanted off the label, and basically broke the band up and formed Type O Negative, and he recorded the first Type O Negative record on his own. It's actually a demo. And he pressed it on cassette and started shopping it around. And then, of course, Roadrunner's owner, Case Wessels, got wind of this and sent Peter a cease and desist saying, you know, you're signed to Roadrunner. You can't be shopping this. And, you know, so Peter realized that. And so Case turned to me at that point, and I had a copy of the album, and he said, you know, Peter's unhappy. Should we let him go and just let him take this elsewhere? Or should we do a new deal with him? And I heard the album, thought it was amazing, and told Case, like, you'd be nuts to drop this. This is better than Carnivore. This is fucking amazing. And so because of that, we actually decided to keep Pete under the contract as opposed to letting him out. And we renegotiated the deal and gave him better terms. And of course, by the time the first Type O Negative record came out in 91, we started to staff up and have a little bit more power as a label. So when we put that record out, you know, I think Peter was happier. So, did I sign Type O Negative? I mean,
I guess signed Carnivore. Yeah, like you signed Carnivore through contracts. Well,
but also, like, you had the foresight to kind of look through this, you know, bad situation where, you know, your boss was looking at Pete and saying that it's erratic behavior, but you knew that Pete was talented. And that there was going to be something down the road if he stuck around.
Well, I look at it that way as well. So I do include Type O Negative in the list of bands I signed. But, you know, if you put an asterisk on it, it kind of predated me there. And, you know, there's a little bit more to it than just, like, I discovered Pete out of the blue. So, but yeah, I do consider it one of my signings. And I'm glad you see it the same way.
So as an A&R guy, are you working with artists or are you working with managers? Like, how does that work?
You work with everybody. Obviously, you work with the artists because that's where it all starts. You work with the managers because most artists have managers. Mm-hmm. You work with the other people at the label. You know, when you sign a band, it's when you bring a band into the label, it's coming because of you. You're the person where the belief starts. So you have to convince the rest of your team. You're like, you know, like, so if I sign Type O Negative, it's like I'm their dad within the label, and I got to go around to all the departments making sure that everyone's paying attention to my band. And I got to convince them of, you know, the magic of the band and the vision I have. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are professionals working at labels, and these people are going to do their jobs anyway, you'd like to think. But, you know, it definitely helps if they feel your passion, because if they see the excitement coming from you, it makes them more excited. And also, especially nowadays, labels have tons of bands, tons of albums they put out. And, you know, the more of a fuss you make as the A&R guy, the more you're running around championing the band, the more attention it's going to get. So, yeah, you got to deal with the artists, their managers, and people at the label, as well as, you know, people in the rest of the business. You know, if you sign a band like Type O Negative, you want to help them get a booking agent, or you want to get a magazine to write about them. You want to get a radio station to play them. So you really just become an all-around ambassador for the band within the music business. But your main duties are restricted to dealing with the band, their manager, their producer, and the people at your label.
When you're looking for a new band nowadays, what do you look for? Like, how can a band get your attention to the point where you're like, you know what, I'm going to pursue this, I want to sign this band?
Well, let's put it this way. I'm pretty damn jaded at this point.
Of course.
I've been doing it for a long time.
I can imagine.
So it takes a lot to impress me, and I've heard it all, I've seen it all, but, you know, I look for the same thing I looked at back when I was 23 years old doing this for the first time. I look for two things, either originality or an angle. So originality could be, you know, a band like Type O Negative. They sound like no one else. Bands like Queens of the Stone Age, System of a Down, Korn. These are all, you know, Slipknot. These are all trailblazing bands that when they came out, there was nothing like them. Or Pantera, for example. I mean, what sounded like Pantera before Pantera? No one. But the thing is, if you're going to restrict the bands you sign simply to bands that exhibit originality, you're going to sign, like, you know, a band every few years. Because how often do those bands that I just mentioned come around? Right? Not too often. So in lieu of looking for something totally original and unique, you also look for bands that have an angle. So, for example, when Sepultura came along, you know, a lot of people considered Sepultura to be, you know, Brazil's version of Slayer. It's not like, you know, when I signed Sepultura, they had had the Schizophrenia record out, right? That was the record before Beneath the Remains, which is the Roadrunner debut. And at the time, Sepultura were just, you know, they were like a baby Slayer. So there wasn't really anything original about Sepultura at the time, but they had an angle. The angle was that they were from Brazil. And I know that now that doesn't mean anything because metal is such an international thing. You have bands from all over the world, you know, like, you know, bands from Finland, Sweden. I mean,
just everywhere.
There's not a, you know, Gojira from France. Like, there's not a country world, for the most part, that's not producing some metal band. But back in 1988, when I signed Sepultura, the idea of a metal band from Brazil was like groundbreaking. So that was an angle to get the band some attention. And in addition to signing bands at Roadrunner, I was also the label manager and the publicist all at the same time for like a brief period because I told you we were a small label at the time, four or five people. And when you're a small label like that, you're wearing a lot of different hats. So I was also the publicist for Sepultura. And I can tell you that when I was calling the publicist at Rip Magazine or Metal Maniacs or, you know, the mags that used to exist back then. Remember magazines? And, you know, when I'd call these people and try and pitch them on bands and they'd hear that Sepultura was from Brazil, right away their interest was piqued. They thought it was newsworthy. And, you know, even a band like Obituary, you know, Obituary didn't invent death metal, but if you listen to the vocals of John Tardy, nobody sounds like that guy back then. And, you know, one of the angles of Obituary was that he wasn't really singing lyrics. He was kind of just growling and grunting and making sounds that fit the music. People thought that was thrilling. The minute I told people that, they're like, okay, sign me up. I want to write about this band. And, you know, an angle could be something as simple as, you know, the singer is crippled. He's in a wheelchair. Or, you know, the guitar player is missing two fingers. Like, basically anything to get attention and get people to care.
But you wouldn't suggest that an upcoming band sever some fingers just to get attention. It's like you need to already have the injury or else it doesn't count.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. So, yeah, those would be the two things. Like, ideally, in a perfect world, you sign bands because they're making music that no one else has made and it's totally original and compelling. Or if in lieu of that, you find something really cool that's different about them. Maybe if it's not musically, maybe it's their image. You know, look at a band like Guar, who I didn't sign, by the way. But, you know, nothing great or particularly original about Guar's music, but, I mean, who looks as a stage show like that? And that was, you know, and then Guar had a career because of that. So, there you go.
And on the other side of things, if someone wanted to enter the business realm, if there's a kid out there who is basically like the 18-year-old version of you, works at their local college radio station, lives metal, breathes metal, and wants to get into the business side of things, you know, ideally working as an A&R guy, but, you know, that's a lot of responsibility for someone right out of college.
Or maybe someone who doesn't particularly know like what path they want to take.
Right. Like, how would you recommend they enter the music, the business side of things, like the label side of things or something like that, get their foot in the door?
Right. Well, like I said, I kind of just fell into this job. I didn't go to college wanting to be an A&R guy. And, you know, speaking specifically about A&R, I don't think it's something you can really you can train for. I mean, you're like, it's not like you can go to college and take a course in A&R or study it. It's kind of like an innate ability, kind of the way, you know, a musician has an innate talent to play and write. So I don't know. I don't know if you could really train for it. I mean, maybe you could look at my period at the radio station as training. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was doing that for 4 years. I was, you know, kind of learning what was good at the time. Yeah, I guess that was my training ground for what I do. I was very fortunate in that I was basically at ground zero of what was an emerging scene at that point. You know, the whole speed thrash death metal scene. And I became an expert in that. And therefore, because I was an expert, I had a value to record labels. Mm-hmm. So labels that wanted the cool new stuff looked at me as their entry point for that.
So, but what I'm hearing for the most part is luck. Just because it's like as someone who's worked in the music industry too, it's a lot of just like, you know, as long as you can get your shit done and be reliable.
Well, Rob was an intern for Roadrunner. Would you say that internships are a great way to expose yourself to what's out there?
Yes. Yeah, definitely. It's good to get your feet wet and just network within the industry, you know, meet people at record companies. You know, and by the way, an easy entry point still for the music business is to do college radio promotion. The only problem is that, you know, things have changed at the labels and everyone is looking to save money. A lot of labels don't even have college radio departments anymore. What they do is they hire out the indies, people like Munzee at Skateboard Marketing or people at the Syndicate. They are now doing college radio for labels because labels don't have their own college radio departments. So if you can't get a job doing that at a label, you could maybe get hired by the Syndicate, for example. And the reason that's such an easy entry point is because you don't really need to know anything about the business. You just have to love metal and like to gab about it. Mm. But one other thing I would say is that if you can, you know, and this is not easy to do, but as a kid, if you can kind of tap into a scene, ground zero of a scene, for example, like you're the first kid that discovers Gent or, you know, the Rise Records metalcore type sound. If you can be a young kid that's plugged into a scene and knows that scene and get there right before that scene explodes, then you're in a position to do what I did, which of course is to get someone to pay you to introduce them to those type of bands. Of course, the only negative there is that scenes change. So for example, if you get a job at a label because you're a Gent expert, then of course, you know, 2-3 years later when Gent is all dried up and everyone's moved on, you're going to be screwed unless you're able to adapt and discover new types of music. So, for example, in my case, when I started at Roadrunner, I was signing a lot of speed thrash and death metal. But, of course, death metal was really starting to die down by about 93, and labels were looking to do different types of things, and I was able to adapt and sign other types of bands. So, to conclude, being an expert in a scene might help you get your foot in the door at a label, but you're going to have to be able to adapt afterwards because no scene lasts forever.
Yeah, you've adapted very well. Like you were saying, in the mid to late 90s, you guys at Roadrunner were signing more new metal bands, and then through the 2000s was the new wave of American heavy metal and all that. And what I want to ask you is, how do you prevent yourself from being too jaded? Like, it's your job to listen to heavy metal. How do you make it not feel like a job?
I mean, it becomes harder and harder as you get older, to be honest. You know, when I was 23 years old doing this, I was doing it because I had to do it, because it's what I love to do. So, you know, on weekends, I would be listening to bands, I'd be going to shows, you know, it's just what I did. Of course, as you become older, you start having kids, you have wives, family, and all of a sudden you have to make time in your schedule to go see shows and to listen to metal. It really does truly become like a job as you get older. I know, like, young kids listening are probably like, how could it be a job to do A&R? It's like the dream job. But you know what? When you're 50 years old, you have a wife and kids, it becomes a job, like anything else. So it is, you know, it is challenging. It's definitely challenging to keep doing this as you get older, because every year that you age, you're 1 year removed from a 16-year-old kid who's got his finger on the pulse. So you got to be on your game and work, you know, you really got to work your ass off to stay relevant in this business. And, you know, that's why you don't see a lot of guys doing it, you know, into their 50s and 60s. They either burn out or they lose touch. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, I don't know if that answered your question.
No, it did. Do you listen to non-metal? Like, when you're not working, you're like, I'm not working, I need to put something else
jazz
on. Or something like that.
Well, one thing you guys, I mean, you're all much younger than me, but one thing you're going to find is that as you get older, your tastes really start to evolve. I remember when I was listening to Metallica and Slayer and Megadeth and, you know, all that cool stuff in the early 80s, I would laugh, you know, like I had a buddy of mine, my best friend, who was a lot more musically open than I was. So he was trying to listen, he was like trying to get me to listen to Jethro Tull and Steely Dan and the Eagles. And, you know, I was like some 18-year-old kid. I was laughing at him, like, get this crap away from me. I, like, literally, like, I'd spit on the records, you know? And you of course, as you get older, your tastes start to change. And now I'm finding that I'm listening to all kinds of stuff that I would have laughed at as a kid. So now I love Jethro Tull. I love Steely Dan. I love the Eagles. I love classic rock, all that stuff. I basically have more mature and open-minded tastes than I've ever had in my life. And every year that goes by, I'm into different things. I recently, you know, I'm listening to a lot of country music these days. There's basically nothing I'm not into except I hate hip hop. I guess I hate hip hop. That's a pet peeve of mine. But what I tend to do, guys, just so you know, is I try and stay focused during the week. And, you know, during the week, I'm only listening to the music I work with and demos. And then what I'll do is I'll set aside one day a week, usually on a Friday night if I'm home. And on that night, I'll listen to stuff that I want to hear as a fan of music as opposed to things I work with. And what I tend to listen to on Friday nights is, like, you know, some of those older bands that I mentioned before. But then once that night is over, I kind of stay focused and just listen to metal the rest of the week because it's my job.
Great. And one last question
and I
have.
Still, you know, and I still love metal as much as I ever did. Like, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
It's just now I love a lot of other things as well.
Yeah, we get it.
One last question. You were saying, like, you listen to demos. And how long do you listen to a demo? How long do you give it a shot before you're like, nope? Because you're listening to hundreds of demos a day or a week, I'm assuming. So, like, what is your – do you have, like, a time or how do you know?
Well, I definitely have a method because you do get so many things in that I'll put something on quickly just to determine if it's shit or not. In other words, I can listen to something right away and know if it's shit. If it's shit, I just get rid of it. I get it out of my face, off my desk, away from me.
10 seconds in? Like how many seconds do you need to listen to something before you can tell it's shit?
Usually within a minute.
Within a minute,
sometimes
okay.
Quicker, but it only takes a minute to hear if something is good or not, as far as, you know, whether it's got good vocals or not, whether it's a bar band versus a real band. When I say bar band, meaning it's just like some local band that you could find anywhere. Like, you can tell it's not professional, you know?
Right, right.
And what I do is I just try and weed through them so I get, like, I just have one instant test where it either goes in a junk pile or it goes in the pile for further consideration. And then, so in other words, if I'm starting with 20 demos, right away you can, like, throw 17 of them out. You'll hear that they're crap. But then when I have three that are left, I will make time and I'll give a serious listen to those three. I'll set time aside and I'll give it a, you know, really, really listen. So that's the first thing I like to do is just get rid of all the crap so that I can focus on what I need to focus on.
That's a very interesting strategy.
Yeah.
I actually have a question too. This is another just like the minutia of work type question. What percentage of time spent at your job is spent finding new bands, and what percentage is spent dealing with the bands you've already signed, and which do you prefer?
You know, that's always a struggle because for me, what I prefer absolutely is discovering bands. Like the ideal, that's the greatest joy in the world, is to discover some band that no one's ever heard of and see this band go on to success. There's no greater reward in the business. So the discovery part's the most exciting for me. And then what happens is once you start having a roster of artists, you know, I'm working with like 15 or 20 different bands right now, and those bands are very time-consuming. So you wind up actually spending most of your time A&Ring and helping, you know, the bands that you have signed to the label making records. So as you go on, it becomes harder and harder to do the discovery part, and because you're just spending more and more time on the bands you have. But I really enjoy the discovery part. You know, for me, what would be a dream job is if I was able to simply discover bands and get them signed to the label and then hand them off. Mm. You know, because if I had a guy like me who I could hand them off to make the records, then I could just spend, you know, the 24 hours a day on the discovery, which is really the fun part.
Well, cloning technology,
but it doesn't work that way. You gotta, you know, when you sign a band, you gotta see it through. That's just the way it is.
Okay, and one follow up on the whole discovering bands thing. Since you've basically been in this, like, almost from the inception to now, and you've seen technology change the music industry in so many different ways, how much harder is it now to really discover something now that everything is like instantly online and accessible to anyone and everyone? Is it harder?
Well, it is harder because in the old days, right, bands had to go in the studio and record real demos. It wasn't possible for bands to make homemade demos that sounded good. So if a band decided they wanted to submit something to me at Roadrunner, they would have had to go into a studio and record a real demo and then, you know, put it on cassette or press it onto a CD, put a promo package together, mail it. You know, there's a lot of effort involved in that. Nowadays, any band, you know, you could be one guy in a band, could sit there and do like a one-man band, if need be, on his computer and get decent quality and send it to me with the click of an email.
Yeah.
So it becomes so much, you know, the point of entry for a band to do this is so much easier. So therefore, I'm actually bombarded with more music than I've ever had before. So it's more, it's kind of like trying to find a needle in a haystack now because you're just, because it's so easy to get demos to label people. And in addition, back in the old days, bands had to be good. Like, they had to actually be able to play their instruments. Now they can fake it. Yeah. They could program their drums. They could auto-tune their vocals. And you know what? Bands that are in their bedrooms doing this are getting signed before playing a single gig because there's more labels than ever hungry to sign up anything. So I'll give you a perfect example. When I signed Slipknot, I actually had been speaking to Slipknot for 9 months before I signed them. What happened was they were sending me demos, and this is even before Corey Taylor was in the band when they had their old singer, Anders. They were sending me demos, and I would, you know, was interested, and I was just waiting to hear the magic. And I didn't like the first few Slipknot demos, and then they got Corey Taylor in the band, and the demos started getting better, of course, because Corey's amazing. And but he, you know, I even got a demo with Corey with two songs that I still passed on, and I said, you know what, this isn't good enough yet, keep going. And finally, they did a demo with the song Spit It Out. And the modern Slipknot that we know and love today was born with that demo of Spit It Out, which is actually the version on the first record. It's the demo. Wow. And that was a perfect example of me basically watching something develop and giving it the space to develop and waiting for it to be ready. That would never happen now. Now you get a band like Slipknot, they get signed before they even left their bedroom because everybody's just, you know, there's so much competition, there's so many labels that labels are signing bands before they're developed, because if they wait, they're going to lose it.
Yeah,
because
in essence, yeah,
labels
no
are willing
time.
To sign it before it's developed. So it's way, way harder than it used to be. It really is. Harder to find like good bands and harder to give them the space to develop and be ready.
Very interesting. Lots of great insight. Thank you, Monty, so much I feel like
no problem, Rob.
We could have spent another hour talking.
Yeah, we could probably just talk to you for another couple of hours.
At some point, we're going to need to get him back on the line and do a thrash it or trash it.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, he's the ultimate authority.
Yeah, that's
who better?
True.
We do a segment on the show called Thrash It or Trash It, which is essentially
what you do at your desk.
A&R process, which is we will listen to a song for a minute and decide if we like it, like if we thrash it or we trash it.
With unsigned bands.
And
we have listeners submit.
Well, have any of your Smash, well, which is, wait, I guess Smash It is a band that go ahead.
Thrash
It. Have any of your Smash It's gone on to get signed?
Thrash, and we'd say
we trashed Chelsea Grin.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right,
really bad. Right before they got signed and blew up, that's like the one notable.
That was mainly for the triangle, though.
Yeah. To be fair, their demos sounded a lot different.
But we attribute the success to the show.
Yeah, so, definitely, you know, we made them.
We gave them that kickstart.
Anyone else? That
well, I was never the biggest Chelsea Grin fan myself, but I really liked that EP Evolved that I thought was great. I mean, it was very aptly named because the band really did evolve on that release. I didn't think the newest thing they did was quite as good as that, but they definitely became a real band with that Evolve EP.
And they have us to thank.
Yeah, we knew them then.
No, just kidding.
What big releases do you have in the pipeline this year? Do you have anything you want to plug before we let you go?
Let's see. Well, we have the new Nightwish record coming at the end of the month.
Their first record
with Thor Jansen, which people are really excited about because she's an amazing singer. Like, super versatile. I think the best singer the band had. We have Fear Factory finishing up their new record, which is really going to turn some heads, and it feels great to be reunited and back in the trenches with Dino, helping him, well, ideally helping him to make a masterpiece. That's the goal. And we have a new record by Thy Art Is Murder being finished up now as well. One of our, you know, new baby bands that has really taken off on the first record. We have Mexican Drug Lords Brujeria returning for the first time, putting out a record later this year. Right now, I'm also in the demo process with Scorpion Child. I don't know if you guys remember their debut record. It came out about a year and a half ago, but they've got a new record that they're finishing up. And God, there's at least three or four things I'm working on that are escaping me right now.
Definitely
a lot of good stuff coming in.
Sorry, an unlikely friend of Nightwish is Richard Dawkins. He tweeted an interview with Tomas where he was talking about, well, it was just a very strange interviewer, but she was basically questioning his religious beliefs. But it was a very insightful interview, and it definitely, I didn't realize that what their new album would be about, and I definitely have more respect for him after seeing that.
Oh, Thomas, well, Tuomas, I guess is how you say his name. The guy's a genius. Yeah. You know, one thing I should point out as well is there are certain bands that need A&R and certain bands that don't. When you're working with a guy like Thomas from Nightwish, there's nothing to do except to email him and say, hey, when the record's done, send it to me. You know?
Nice.
And my job, by the way, because it's not an ego thing with me, is that, you know, when you work with certain bands, sometimes the best thing you can do as their A&R guy is just to stay out of their way and don't fuck things up. Mm. So when you're working with a genius like Peter Steele or Thomas from Nightwish, you know, you just let them do their thing, or Michael from Opeth. And then again, there are other bands that are young and very much need direction and need handholding and need your input. So the amount of A&R attention I give a band varies from tons to zero, and it just depends on who the band is and what stage you're at. I mean, I don't have this crazy ego where I need to put my stamp on a record. I'm perfectly willing to accept it with no involvement whatsoever if the band, you know, do it on their own. And Nightwish is the perfect example of a band that basically A&Rs themselves.
Cool. Awesome, Monty. Well, have a great night and a great rest of your week. Thank you again so much for hanging out with us.
All right, no problem, guys.